Would you turn off that rock and rock music?
Hey, you don't have a stegosaurus, man.
These talking dinosaurs are more real than most real families on TV.
Look, Maggie, they have a baby, too.
It's like they saw our lives and put it right up on screen.
Welcome back to What the Hell Happened to Them. This season, we are making Whoopi, that's right, Whoopi Goldberg, Hangin Ten. 10 curated films from the long, long career of Whoopi Goldberg. Joining me on the line is the head dinosaurologist, Joe Vekeman.
Thank you. I think you are the head dinosaurologist, though, in this podcast.
And our sponsor this week is... Still Godzilla Minus One, Joe!
Wow.
Still Godzilla. They love us. It can't be stopped. Yes, and their item they're having a sponsor this week is the Godzilla Flask. Give your breath that radioactive need with alcohol on the go. The Godzilla Flask. Sneak it into a theater today. Joe, what movie is number 6 in our Hangin' 10?
Number 6 is 1995's Theodore Rex. This is a your pick. I'm calling you out. This is a your pick.
Well, what came out?
Hey, human!
Alright, hold on. Love's Matt. I didn't introduce him. And on the audio boards is Lev Van Rensselaer reminding me to remind you that you can email the cast at whathappenedtothemcast@gmail.com. Alright, Lev, I'm sorry.
And somebody's a grabbing my boy.
Alright, what happened in between this and our previous film? What did we skip over?
Made in America. I think that was 93. And then there was Sister Act 2, Back in the Habit. Then she voiced Shenzi in The Lion King. She was Buckwheat's mom in The Little Rascals. This is all 94. Then she's in Corinna Corinna, where she plays Corinna Washington. She's in Star Trek Generations as... Oh, that is... That's a lot of vowels in that name. So I'm just going to move on from that.
Well, it's a role she still plays to this day, in fact.
It's her Star Trek role. That's right. Whatever that's... I don't want to mispronounce it.
Patrick Stewart's got that show on CBS. She's in that, like, all the time.
Oh, she just shows up in that?
Yeah.
She's Fantasy in The Pagemaster, and that concludes her 1994, where she's running the table on kids' movies.
I don't know what Corinna Corinna is, but I can't imagine that's a kid's movie.
Oh, you know what?
I don't.
I'm seeing here, I don't know how this happened, because I was almost certain that Theodore Rex was before Boys on the Side, but I'm seeing Old Switcheroo! Somehow Boys on the Side came out before Theodore Rex.
Uh-oh. Well, it's too late now, Joe.
I mean, it's...
The die has been cast.
Yeah, it's February and July. It's within the next, like, 5 months. Anyways, so in Theodore Rex, she plays Katie Coltrane. Did you know that? Did you know she plays the character Katie Coltrane?
I remember them calling her Coltrane a lot and being like, I know that musician. But that was really it.
Well, they say her name. Every scene she walks into, they always introduce her to every character, no matter if she's talking to them or not.
Will you give us a plot synopsis for all the people
who
haven't seen it?
You want a plot synopsis of Theodore Rex? Of course I can. In an alternate futuristic society, a tough female police detective is paired with a talking dinosaur to find the killer of dinosaurs and other prehistoric animals, leading them to a mad scientist bent on creating a new Armageddon. A new Armageddon.
All right, let me...
Yep.
I want to get this on the record first.
Give it to me.
I'm sorry, everybody.
This was fucking rough.
You know, you tell me that Whoopi Goldberg has a movie with dinosaurs, I'm going to pick it. Sight unseen. It's just my way, but this was very, very, very bad.
It was trying at times. I was like, this is a 90-minute movie. It felt like a full 2 hours.
This was a truly terrible film. We are getting, you know, we're close to whatever. What are the Planet 51 territory?
Eight Crazy Nights. Are we close to a crazy night?
Yeah, almost there too. Uh-huh.
Wow. Wow.
It's very bad.
Yeah, no, I was just like, just leave it on. If I had to walk in and out of the room, I was like, meh, what am I going to miss?
Yeah, I don't play. I like, because you'd be like, oh no, but plot points. But I, for most of the movie, I don't know why stuff was happening.
Neither do I.
It's a movie that seems to be made for kids, but I, like, things just are occurring. Yeah.
You think it's made for kids?
Well, yeah. So I'm like, well, you don't want it to be too complicated. But they decided to make it so uncomplicated. Things are just happening. There seems to be little in the way of cause and effect. And it's just like the screenwriter's like, well, we got to do this now. And then it happened. And I don't know how any of it made sense. I don't know really why anyone was doing anything. And whenever there was a problem, suddenly it would be solved. Usually from a tail accidentally hitting something.
That is a lot of what happens in this movie. Someone's tail hits something, and boy, is that a problem.
And it seems weird that, like, everybody's like, all right, well, of course we've got dinosaurs alive again. They're, you know, been brought back to life by this guy. No one's like, huh, it's weird that this guy wanted to anthropomorphize dinosaurs, but maybe he didn't. Like, maybe dinosaurs... Remember that show, Dinosaurs?
I was going to bring up. This reminds me of the show Dinosaurs without any of the, like, interesting ideas that show was bringing to it, for at least a kid's show.
Yeah, it seems to be all the same people behind it.
The puppets look very similar.
And in fact, I looked up the guy. I'm like, oh, who's this guy voicing the dinosaur? But, you know, when you look up the actor of Theodore Rex, you get the guy who's in it, who's in the suit.
Yeah.
Who has, like, this crazy Slavic name.
Yep.
Yeah. You have it there?
Yeah, I do.
What is it? I don't remember.
His name's George like Newbern.
No, that's the voice actor.
Who's the guy in the suit?
Yeah, his name's like Mons or something. Mons or...
Okay, hold on. I'm getting...
And you look at him and you're like, wow, you should be like Dr. Caligari or something.
they pushed... well, that's Tina Rex voice performer. That's Jan Robson.
Kane.
Yeah, Jan Robson. I'm looking for our man in the suit. Right, it's a man, right?
Theodore Rex. Man in the suit, yeah.
Here we go. Theodore Rex puppet and Oliver Rex puppeteer are Bruce Linoyle. Michelin Sisti is the reptilian reverend puppeteer. Ah, I found him.
Yeah.
Theodore Rex performer, Pons Mar.
Pons, not Mons. Pons, yeah.
Pons Mar.
And he's also the head dinosaur puppeteer as well. And they all, like, did the work, too, on the other one.
You know, he kind of looks like Theodore Rex, like his IMDb photo.
Yeah.
He looks like his puppet. Do you think they were like...
No. Because he's done dinosaur puppets, and the show had just ended. So, like, they were like, oh, all these dinosaur guys need work. Let's do this movie and get the dinosaur guys. They've already done the dinosaur work.
Yeah, I'm looking at it. He was the lead puppeteer in Monkey Bone. He did 62 episodes of Dinosaurs. That's right. So from 91. You know what?
Nope.
He was in he did 62 episodes of Dinosaurs from 91 to 94, I think, when that show ended. And then he's like, I got all these puppets, you know, I'm pretty good at puppeteering dinosaurs. Let's get Whoopi on the phone. I don't know. I got more information with Whoopi.
Who's the director? Does the director do anything? Because I hope not.
I hope not.
This is some of the worst directing I've ever seen. Was this like a TV movie? Is this like a real movie?
It's a real movie. It's from New Line.
Yeah, everybody should... Like, I really hope everybody knew they were not making something good.
I wish this was so much easier. So his name is Jonathan R. Butel? Butel? Butel?
Beetlejuice.
Beetlejuice? Here we go. Jonathan Beetlejuice.
Jonathan R. Beetlejuice.
Born in 1949, this is a movie he wrote and directed. This is his vision. Complete vision right here.
I can't believe this was somebody. I was hoping this was going to be like a mangled studio committee movie.
Oh, you wish.
This is somebody's treasure planet.
This is someone's treasure planet. That is... Wait, okay. I'm going to jump to this. There's a Whoopi Goldberg lawsuit. I'm looking at this right now. Though Whoopi Goldberg had made an oral agreement to star in the film in October of 1992, 3 years before the movie comes out, she attempted to back out. I wonder why.
Because she saw the script? Yeah.
She saw the writing on the wall after earning an Academy Award. It was like, I think I jumped into too many projects. She attempted to back out. Abramson filed a $20 million lawsuit against Whoopi Goldberg, which was settled quickly. Goldberg agreed to star in the film for $7 million, $2 million more than the amount originally agreed upon. Wow, so even though she was trying to back out, she got more money than she was promised.
Well, if they're going to make her do it, she might as well get something out of it, because it's not going to be box office gross percentages.
You know what? Maybe I'm wrong. This movie made some money. I mean, maybe not made money, but seemed to produce money at the box office. I don't know if it was a...
What was the budget of the movie?
I wish I could tell you. Oh, wait. I'm looking at it. I'm all over the place today. Looks like it was made for $33.5 million, which in 95 is a chunk
of
change.
That's insane. Holy crap.
That's a lot of money for this little tiny movie where not much happens. There's a lot of puppets. I mean, that's... Oh, more information has come to light.
Breaking news, everybody, from 1995.
The film was originally intended for theatrical release in North America during Christmas of 1995. So there, hey, it should have come after Boys on the Side.
Wait, so they released it like 10 months earlier?
No, they released it, no, because...
Oh, 10 months later.
Yes.
Okay.
This came out in July. This was supposed to come out in Christmas in 95. So I got 6 months pushed up.
It got pushed up. So it was going to come out in 96.
Because there was a glut of competition. The glut of competition was Casino and Heat and Toy Story.
Well, you don't want to go up against Toy Story, but I think you're fine against Heat and Casino. You don't seem to be drawing the same crowds.
This is movies. I mean, Whoopi.
Yeah.
Whoopi.
Whoop, whoop, whoop.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing. Watching 6 episodes, that theme is in my head.
All 10 seconds of it.
I mean, it's a good theme.
It's a good theme. Listen, they're in, they're out. We know the show's called Whoopi. It doesn't have the yes, dear problem.
Enlighten me. What is the yes, dear problem?
The yes, dear problem is that nobody knew what the fuck the show was called. And after 5 seasons, they're like, oh, I guess we should change the theme song so people remember what the fuck our show is. And they just say, like, yes, dear, like, 80 times in 20 seconds.
Like the 2.5 Men theme song.
Yeah.
Men.
Everybody knows the name of that TV show.
I've never watched one full episode, and I know that
Yes.
Song.
There you go. They did the job. All right. So the movie got pushed.
It got pushed
around.
Pushed up.
To avoid all the casino people.
Casino and Heat. I think it's Toy Story. I know. I was struggling to think of what comes out in 95 in a FETA glitter competition, blah, blah, blah. They subsequently intended to release it to coincide with Goldberg's hosting stint at the Academy Awards the following year, but ultimately decided that it was in their best interest to release the film direct to video.
So it didn't go to theater.
It didn't go to theaters.
Ah! I was right. Not
this
a real
decision,
movie.
Came as a result of failed test marketing in
everywhere.
This is definitely where you want to test this movie: in Las Vegas, Memphis, Portland, Maine, and Providence, Rhode Island.
You know what? You know what? If you had said Portland, Oregon, I might get it. The Memphis one seems odd too. Providence, Rhode Island.
Yeah, Providence. That's great.
Las Vegas is they're kooky there. You could do it there.
I would have been 5 years old if I saw this when I was 5. I think this would have been one of my favorite movies.
You know, I'm so glad to hear Whoopi trying to back out, because the whole time I'm watching, I'm like, why is she clearly not giving a shit?
Yeah, she is checked out.
If she knew the project were terrible, why did she sign on? Like, is she already in the take any project stage of her career? She's still doing well, it seems. No, she didn't want to be there. Okay, all right, fine. Maybe, like, she hadn't seen a script when she agreed, you know? Maybe it was just, like, she saw the storyboards and the lookbooks, and she was like, wow, this could be really cool. This is a unique thing.
Oh, you know that new ABC show, Dinosaurs, that's airing right
now? Yeah.
We've got an idea. You're going to be this cop, and you're going to be working with the dinosaurs.
We got pawns from that show. And she's like, you got fucking pawns? Holy shit.
Emmy Award winner? We don't know. I don't know. In a 2015 interview with the Brazilian newspaper.
Wait. Isn't she in Monkey Bone?
She is in Monkey Bone.
What? You think Pons got her the job?
I think the relationship between them is strong since they had to work on this movie for a while.
They had to both work on this piece of shit thing, and they're just like, and he's in the suit, so like he takes off the head, and he's like, fuck, I can't believe we're doing this, Whoopi.
And then 5 years later, when they're making Monkey Bone, he takes off the hat. He's like, hey, Pons!
Pons, you're the Monkey Bone?
How do we get together? Because I'm just recording a voice in the studio.
Yeah.
I'm not actually on set with Fraser. That's fine. So in 2015, Goldberg stated that this is the only film she regrets ever having done. Don't ask me why I did it.
Hold on.
Yeah?
To interrupt. She is done.
Yes.
Wait, when was the interview? What was the interview?
2015.
You have done like 400 movies, Whoopi. This is the only one?
The only one.
That can't possibly be true.
Don't ask me why I did it. I didn't want to, she said. Goldberg also
why
said
you
to
did
me,
it? Because you had a lawsuit against you. That's why you did it. I know why you did it.
We do now.
They knew then. The lawsuit didn't happen after the fact.
Maybe the lawsuit was just like pushed under some papers, and you were like, I don't know about this anymore.
Yeah, but we're not allowed to talk about it.
She also said it made no sense to anybody to like it.
Yes. Okay, what did the director do anything else after this direct-to-DVD joint?
Jonathan R. Butel did a movie 10 years earlier in 1985. He made My Science Project, which looks kind of similar. Stars, holy shit, John Stockwell, Dennis Hopper, definitely slumming it.
That's a Blue Velvet reunion, isn't it?
I think you're thinking of Dean Stockwell.
Yeah, I am. Yeah.
I wish it was a Blue Velvet. Because that would have been, like, the next year they were, like, on set on Dave Lynch. Like, what, he's just in that shitty movie with that guy? I don't know if this is shitty. Maybe it's good.
You know, there was the commissioner in this movie. They call him Commissioner Lynch. And I would just be like, Commissioner David Lynch? And if they got him to play the commissioner, whoo, what a movie we'd have.
Have you heard of the movie The Last Starfighter?
Yes.
This is a movie directed by Nick Castle, who I believe was the...
Not this director.
No. That is, he's best known for portraying the body of Michael Myers in Halloween.
Okay. Why'd you bring him up? It's because he's in this movie too?
Because he directed The Last Starfighter, which is the only other credit. It's only a writing credit, though, that Jonathan R. Butel has. So his credits are The Last Starfighter for screenplay. And then he has two directing credits, which is Theodore Rex and My Science Project. I believe after Theodore Rex, they were like, no more.
I feel good about that. I feel good.
Yeah.
You know, we didn't get David Lynch as the commissioner, but, you know, we did get some guy from the Drew Carey show to be like her work scientist friend.
We did. Who was this guy?
I don't know what his name is, but he's in an episode where Drew Carey's trying to get a zoning permit for the brewery he has in his garage. And this guy is there every week to complain about aliens in his neighborhood.
Okay.
So there you go. I remember him from that episode.
Wow. That is specific.
Which probably came out a year or two after this movie came out.
You kept referencing Commissioner Lynch, played by Richard Roundtree. You know, Shaft, the original Shaft, who passed away earlier this year.
He and Whoopi are like, all right, how'd you get into this? A lawsuit, yeah. How'd you get into this? Oh, bad money investments? Yeah.
So, you know what? That's a funny year. That's the same year that Richard Roundtree plays a district attorney in Seven. David Fincher's Seven. Same year.
An up and down year for Shaft.
Okay. Yeah, Theodore Rex. What do you got to say about Theodore Rex?
I don't know how the kids didn't like this movie. It's got a ninja district.
Ninja district.
You know, featuring no ninjas, but...
Oh. Most of the actors signed on thinking the dinosaur would be computer enhanced. So they thought...
They thought they were getting Jurassic Park dinosaurs?
Yeah, right after Whoopi sees Jurassic Park, she's like, we're going to do this? I'm going to be in a Jurassic Park movie? You think so?
Listen, anyone who thought that was the thing that was going to save the movie is high.
Yeah.
That actually might have made the movie somehow worse. It is weird, though, for a movie with these dinosaur puppets made by the people who made the dinosaur puppets in the very recent TV kid show. The script doesn't feel, I don't know, all the, it is for kids, but it certainly doesn't look like it's for kids, other than in the dinosaur's house.
The whole time I'm watching this, I'm like, who made this? Like, what? Who's this for?
And I'm trying to figure out, like, if this is for kids, why aren't there jokes?
Yeah, I know. There's no jokes in this.
There's no, right? It's not like an outright
single
comedy.
Joke.
There's actually some, like, darkish moments where the guy's like, there's been a dino side. I gotta go get him. But, like, all the actors are kind of, like, acting like they're in a kid's movie. It's tough. Figure it out.
Says one of the puppeteers of Theodore Rex found it really difficult to perform in the costume. It was very heavy, which often caused him to fall over, and he couldn't see up or down properly. He also said the costume smelled terribly. Does any of that surprise you?
Disney employees everywhere are like, yep, we get it. We know what how it feels, man. Hey, you know what caught me off guard was that apparently Whoopi Goldberg was a robot in this movie. I didn't know that until her second to last scene.
Wait, she's a robot? What are you talking about?
Robot, right? Isn't she like, because like, she gets like robot stunned at the end, didn't she? And then like Theodore Rex had to go alone.
She gets like electro-pulsed into a corner and then like, they're just writing her out from the final scene. I don't know. I don't think she's a robot. Do you think she's a robot?
I think she's a robot. If you guys know whether or not she's a robot, you can email the cast at whathappenedtothemcast@gmail.com. I think she's a robot. And then apparently, I guess there was like this whole gun thing where the moral of the story was like, don't have to use a gun. But she uses a gun all the time. And I think she's not called a police person. I think she's called a gun. And then she's like, no, don't use your gun. Use your brain. But like, why? And one of those two people die anyway when their car crashes, hits a poster and explodes. That was the only time I laughed during the movie. He's like, and he just kind of like drives through some paper and the car explodes. It just explodes in a big impossible blast. $33 million. Good Lord.
The opening crawl was added after test screenings, audience.
Said, we don't know what the fuck's going on here. And guess what? I saw the opening crawl and I go, what the fuck's going on here?
The children in the audience, while liking the film, were visibly confused with much of the sophisticated talk and grown-up plot details. I got a lot of stuff. I just got to get through this. Larry Finch, Whoopi Goldberg's business partner at the time, was banned from the set and fired as her business partner. Finch is quoted as saying, this was the worst deal in which I have ever been involved.
So she was fired by him?
No, the other way around. She fired him.
Yeah, I guess that's what I meant. He was fired. She fired.
Yeah.
I don't know, because he made her do the thing?
Yeah, look what you got me involved with. This shit. When the film opened in Japan in June 1996, so almost a full year after it was released into the United States.
This could be something they might like. They're kind of, they're into some weird stuff.
There was a live tour featuring Teddy, the animatronic dinosaur. Shot in Los Angeles, California on a tight 58 days from November 14th, 1994 to February 17th.
A tight 2 months. That's all you have time for. Uh-oh.
February 17th, 1995. Under the working title T-Rex, principal photography ran 3 days over schedule.
Yeah, I'm sure that made Whoopi happy.
Leonard Nimoy was asked to direct this film. He thought about it, but eventually declined. They're like, you got one hit. Let's make another one. Three Men and a Baby? Can we run it back?
We did a Star Trek.
You did a Star Trek?
We did number four. I think that's the weird one with the whales.
The whales. More crazy stuff that happened with this movie. The Katie Coltrane character was originally written as a white male. Val Kilmer and Kurt Russell were considered for the role. I think considered is doing a lot of heavy lifting there. Considered. Val Kilmer at the height of his power.
All right, so here's my takeaway, is it seems Jack's whole thing was that he was always like the fifth, eighth choice for a role.
Yes.
And Whoopi's thing is, it was never written for a black woman.
It was a white male.
It was always some white male role she was taking.
Whoopi Goldberg was thrown in the mix because Sister Act had just come out and did very well. Producers felt her name was a strong enough draw for foreign investors. The script was rewritten to Whoopi Goldberg's casting because the pairing of a dinosaur was still unique enough that maybe Whoopi would bring some zaniness to it.
Wait, so it's not unique anymore? How many dinosaur team-up police cop movies have you seen, Joe?
I'm not... This is... Oh, wow. Whoopi Goldberg began filming this movie the day after her 39th birthday. Did she... Was she like, well, this is it. This is over. The gravy train is over. It's just over. Actors would be stressed out because the director would constantly rewrite the script. Oh, you don't say. He was writing anything?
I mean, he definitely wrote this. He just didn't write it well. It does explain why the movie's not making too much sense, because he's essentially freeballing it.
After one downbeat rough cut preview of Theodore Rex in June of 1995, so like 3 weeks before the movie comes out, New Line asked the filmmakers to trim some of the more violent segments and rewrite some dinosaur dialogue to clarify the plot.
Beetlejuice had to have known as the edit was coming together. He's like, oh, I've made a piece of crap. I'm never going to work again.
Mary Steenburgen was considered for the voice of Molly.
But Whoopi was like, get that lady out of here.
Originally written in 1989 as T-Rex, writer Jonathan Buttel wanted to take a familiar concept and put a weird spin on it. Oh, he did. The original script was really a gritty sci-fi story.
Oh, was it? The dinosaur puppetry would beg to differ.
It was a dark, futuristic buddy cop movie where one of the buddies just happened to be a dinosaur. Just happened to be a dinosaur. It took 6 years for the producers to get the money to get the film off the ground. Because this was a hot spec script. We could not get enough of this. Dinosaurs in 1989?
So when he's directing, the movie's intended to be dark, gritty sci-fi film?
I guess so.
Why did you get those dinosaur puppets then?
Yeah, doesn't really scream dark and gritty.
You got puppets from a children's TV show, a popular, famous TV's children's show. You made the wrong choice. I mean, even your dark, gritty, sentient toys, not dark and gritty. They're all goofy. I don't know. I don't know if Whoopi's a robot. I'm confused at how the missile's going to cause an ice age. And a surprise to no one, the movie does not pass the Bechdel test. All right, well, we got some Sandler watch. I got Sandler watch, finally.
Sandler watch.
Give me the Sandler watch.
We finally got a teaser, our first teaser and potential release date for Spaceman. They claim it's going to come out in March, so that's out. I happened to catch that this morning.
Well, I haven't, and I'm looking it up right now. Absolutely. Oh, my God, it's 25 seconds long.
We're not going to watch it now. What are you doing?
I'm not. I'm just...
Okay, all right.
Sound off. I'm just looking at it. Is it just the woods?
I don't know. I haven't seen it. I just saw the headline. I'm not going to watch it. I just was like, March, finally. We got a date. 3 years later.
Looks good.
Well, it better be. They spent 2 years of post-production.
It is almost nothing. I hate teaser trailers.
The date is what's important. All right, you want to talk about our Whoopi episodes this week?
Yeah, March 1st. That's the date.
All right, episode 13, we have an airplane thing.
Yeah, she doesn't want to go on the plane. That's funny.
I don't blame her because I hate airplanes too. I think Whoopi's like doing her best stuff so far in this episode. I think she's really bringing it in this one. So she's afraid of flying. All of her poker friends want to go to some tropical island.
They want to go to the Bahamas.
They want to go to the Bahamas, so they're trying to... So the white girl gets her...
Rita.
This, like,
come on.
Rita gets her this... Yeah, she's my favorite character. You think I'd know her name.
I thought so, too.
Gets her, like, this flight simulation therapy thing. And so she and Whoopi go on that. They actually have a nice moment and, like, do some character stuff in there. So I appreciated that, too. A good probing of her character. They do a Paris Hilton sex tape joke. Pretty relevant there.
Yeah.
At the end of the episode, because it's, you know, recorded right from the TV, the TV airing.
Oh, I was going to ask. Yeah.
They're like, stay tuned for an all new Frasier.
Yeah, I was going to let you do that. Because it's always like family something. What is
Happy Family?
Happy Family.
Which, my guess is around this time, they've moved the time slot around a bit on Whoopi. And so after this,
Whoopi.
Now she might have like the 8 o'clock slot and then the Happy Family's at 8:30. Happy Family, I barely remember, and I didn't watch it. I specifically did not watch it.
Yeah, I've never even heard of this show, Happy Family.
It also only had a year, but it had a full year, like Whoopi, and they both got canceled at the end.
So, yeah, I like the airplane episode. That was funny.
Airplane, I thought, was pretty good. Whoopi really touching some good comedy juices there.
The next one?
Yeah, so they think Rita is pregnant.
Is Rita pregnant? That's the episode.
Oh, well, that's convenient there, yeah. So I was having a tough one on this one, but again, we don't have the best audio quality. Mm-hmm. But for some reason, in the early scenes of the show, her face did look a lot more round than normal.
Oh, you thought she was pregnant?
Yeah, maybe she got actual pregnant and they're writing it into the show now. But then in some episodes, and in later parts of this episode, her face looks normal. So I'm like, maybe it's just the way her hair was.
Maybe she was just enjoying catering that day.
Yeah, she got a little bloated.
That's okay.
There's a taxi subplot between the two hotel workers that I feel like doesn't really go anywhere. It just seemed like they had to fill some time with a B story, and that was the best they could do. And then more of the her stand-up segments I talk about this time about birth control in general.
Yes.
But, you know, good for Rita here. The brother wants to, like, marry her because it's, like, the honorable, whatever, old-fashioned thing to do. And she's like, fuck you. I'm a treasure.
Yeah, no, it's so good. She's like, you're supposed to feel like this. I'm your prize. And that's the word. She's, I'm your prize.
I don't
want to
be your obligation.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's good.
So good for her. Good character stuff again. And then she's not pregnant. Spoilers, everybody.
Yeah, she's not pregnant. And then I think Whoopi took a sigh of relief for that. The third episode we watched was The Last Dance. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's interesting. You had a ghost reunion with Patrick Swayze, but you did Dirty Dancing instead.
Yeah, I know. Very strange. But he's like, I don't know, he's like born again because he's like,
yeah, because he got in a motorcycle accident, so he came to Jesus and was not fun anymore. And Whoopi's like, this ain't great.
Yeah, she's like, I got all dolled up for this, and he doesn't want to do anything fun anymore.
And she's like, listen, back when I was in Catholic school, and I'm like, I remember that at the beginning of Sister Act. You know, they talk about her kind of not wanting to get married, but her just, she's like, I liked him because he would like come and then go. And I go, even back then, she didn't want somebody to live in her house.
Oh, yeah. That quote is so good.
She wanted to hit it and quit it. That was her thing.
Yeah. That's why her and Ted didn't work out, apparently, right?
I guess. They make a Janet Jackson breast reveal.
Yeah.
My guess is that just happened.
It had to have.
Right? Right? That was that year.
Because that episode aired February 24th, 2004. That would have happened like 3 weeks earlier. Incredible. That's like South Park timing.
That they were ready to go.
Very timely.
To go. So Patrick Swayze, does he need to do TV at this time? Is he like not doing movies anymore? Is that why he's doing Donnie Darko and sitcoms now?
Yeah, he just did Donnie Darko in 2001. I guess that was a little delayed though. Yeah, I mean, it's kind of over for him. Because that same year he has Dirty Dancing Havana Nights, the prequel where he's the dance class instructor, which doesn't make any sense, but it's okay. He's in a television movie called Icon, and then he's got his show that he did that came out posthumously called The Beast. Do you remember The Beast on, TNT or something?
Nope.
A&E, sorry. Yeah, so his run was over, but it was nice to see him show up on Whoopi.
So Whoopi helping out his pal.
Yeah, he's in and out. I think he's sick at this time, so he's definitely not doing much.
All right, well, back to everybody's favorite, Theodore Rex.
Theodore Rex. A new low for this podcast.
The dystopian future was oddly colorful, which I guess was his attempt at reminding people. No, it was a dark, gritty film. I thought it was like his attempt to remind people it was a kid's film, but now I don't know.
No, it was definitely a dark, gritty film made in 1995 with like
just colors and polygons everywhere.
Yeah, it's very like, it's not neon, but it's very colorful.
It's like, yeah, just like generic matte palettes of blues and reds
everywhere, too. It's not. Yeah, it's everywhere.
Like the police station looks like it's made out of Play-Doh.
What a concept. Who thought this was going to be a good idea? No one. And they still made it. They all were like, why are we doing this?
They were all legally obligated to make it after a certain point.
Too much money had been paid out to people. And like, well, you gotta do it now.
I'm done with this movie. You have anything else you want to get off your chest about the movie?
I'm done. My last looks. Whoopi, I understand what you were thinking. You were trying to get out of it. You did your best. You almost got sued. But you know what? You still got a nice bag. You know, 7 million for doing this movie.
Yeah, well, why does Whoopi do this movie? Because she was contractually obligated to do it. And everyone involved tying her into the contract got removed from her life shortly afterwards. I'm a little surprised to hear that you did Pinocchio 3000 and this is still the only movie you regret.
Wait.
Yes, I don't. Pinocchio 3000. Yeah, I forgot about that one. You got last looks? Is that it?
You didn't want to do the movie? Great. I'm so happy to hear that. I really, really am. You clearly didn't look like you wanted to do the movie on set, so I'm happy to hear that that was intentional.
You didn't want to do the movie? We didn't want to go on to watch the movie.
We're confused at what the movie is, but it seemed like the director was too, which is why it had to be rewritten. I'm glad the kids who watched it were confused. Like, you're doing your dark, gritty sci-fi movie and your test audience is children? Pick a lane.
The children in Providence, Rhode Island were like, we're not impressed. We're confused.
We were told this was going to be a dark, gritty, Buddy Cianci drama. What the fuck? Because the Rhode Island kids are surly. It's a joke that not many people will get. All right, well, then I'm done. We'd like to thank our sponsor, Godzilla Minus One, with the Godzilla flask.
Yes.
Hide all your sweet, sweet juices in there. I hide seltzer water in mine, but you can be hip and cool if you want. I'd like to thank Lev Van Rensselaer for mining those audio boards and keeping the sound so slippery smooth. I'd like to thank my co-host Joe Vekeman for stopping by.
Oh, thank you.
Man, I'm out of it too. I'm sounding like Whoopi and Theodore Rex. I'm just not in it anymore.
It's okay.
I'm just forcing through it. I am your host, Patrick Scale. You can find my features, documentary, short films, video essays, animations, behind-the-scenes footage, and so much more at quixotic.com and social media, presumably with a similar sounding name. Thank you all for listening. Joe, say goodnight.
Good night. I want the dinosaur.
Well, Joe, I feel kind of bad.
Why?
I didn't see Godzilla again this week.
You didn't?
I didn't.
Oh, it's okay. Six times is a lot. I'm still trying to get my first showing in.
Well, at this point, Joe, you might as well wait till I'm back.
Well, it might not be in theaters next week.
Joe, this week it expanded to 20, to the most theaters ever. I don't think it's suddenly going to disappear next week.
I don't know.
Why?
These theaters around Massachusetts are pretty fickle.
I think it's only gotten in more theaters. People are still, like, I just showed you, it's the number one in the America,
yeah.
in UK. Lawrence has been trying to see it a second time, bringing his wife, and they can't find two seats next to each other.
Well, that's scary. I don't like that. Because that used to be beaten by just showing up to the theater early.
Well, now you got assigned seats, man.
Yeah, I hate it. I don't know how you feel about it, but I hate it. Because I just don't like how people are like feel obligated to sit in their seats when there's plenty of other room around us now. And I'm like, hey, I know you sat here, but you could sit way over there if you like.
Yeah, usually I'm not going to the crowded theaters, so I haven't run into that issue where somebody's like, you're in my seat, as we look at every other empty. It's just me and them. But, when the seats are crowded, when the theaters are crowded, you kind of have to follow the rules.
Yeah, I don't mind. I miss the old
I mean, is it in Bellingham right now, Joe? Do you see it in Bellingham right now?
Oh, yeah, no, it's playing right now in Bellingham, but there are limited showings of it right now. There's only three out of the 5 or 6 it had last week.
Sorry, what about that other one near you? The Rhode Island one?
That one might have something.
I've been pushing Alberto and Jake and others to go too. Like, I'm slowly adding cultists.
Well, on Friday they put up their new movie, so I gotta wait till midday.
Yeah, I know.
So I don't know. It's still playing technically there.
I would just be surprised if every theater in Massachusetts, suddenly it's gone.
Yeah, it's got 3 showings left this week in Lincoln.
If the movie just keeps getting more and more popular, I would just be kind of surprised. All of a sudden it went away.
Well, there's like 8 new movies coming out this Friday, so that's the only like pushback.
What movies are coming out this Friday?
Well, I'll tell you. All right, you ready?
Let's see.
We got... The first one I'm seeing is Anyone But You. That is a rom-com starring Sydney Sweeney and Glenn Powell.
Well, the Iron
The Iron Claw, the Von Erichs movie starring Zac Efron.
That's that wrestling one you're talking about.
Yes, hell yeah. Then there's the kids movie, Migration, from Illumination. So that's going to eat up some screens. And then there's Aquaman and the Lost Kingdom, Aquaman 2. That's going to be eating up a lot of screens. Then there's a new Hindi movie playing called Donkey. And plus on Monday, we have The Color Purple. We have Ferrari, Michael Mann's Ferrari. We have George Clooney's The Boys in the Boat. Can't forget those showings. That easily gets four showings because everybody's so pumped for The Boys in the Boat. Even, like, it's just, I don't get it.
Oh, well, I'm looking up the weekend box office.
Yeah, we'll see what's playing there.
I'm checking it out. Godzilla Minus One dropped to number 4.
I was surprised it got more than a week. I told you it was supposed to be a limited showing, and then they obviously were like, hey.
It just made too much
money.
It's
doing well. This isn't a specialty box office now. It's a regular box office.
What movie came out this? I don't know. Trying to fit it. I don't know. How do you find what do you look for box office numbers?
I don't know. I usually give up because it's so awful. They've made it so impossible to find box office receipts now, and I don't like it.
Well, do you think you're going to be able? You would be able to get to it this week anyway?
Oh, I'm definitely going to. I'm prioritizing it. I was supposed to see it Monday, but there was a giant storm where a bunch of trees went down and the roads were really bad. Ellie's school actually got canceled because of that's how bad the storm was. And I'm like, okay. So I stayed in yesterday. I was going to try to go out today if we. Because my son's homesick because he's not doing well. But I got to you too late for this. We needed to start an hour ago. And that was my fault, though, because I had to do grocery shopping. And I didn't even go to the gym. I was so busy with grocery shopping. Then I dropped my grandma's poinsettia off to her because she always likes those for Christmas. And then I drove back home. And then I find out that Ellie didn't wake up Tanya to go to school today. She was just sitting and watching TV. So I had to drive Valley right to school as soon as I got home. And then we had to unpack the groceries. I jumped in the shower and I'm on here with you now.
All right. So the best I can find is that somebody says that Godzilla so far has made $34 million in America.
Incredible.
Here's what's
incredible. Awesome.
So here's why it's incredible. Week one, $11 million. Last week, $8 million.
Oh, wow.
So it actually has made the most money so far this weekend.
And the week's not even over.
Week's not even over, Joe. It could be around Christmas week.
Yeah, we'll go see it.
Very excited. I feel like I've got like withdrawals. I'm like, oh, I haven't seen it in so long.
You're fun.
It's all right. I'm seeing two other Japanese films this week.
What are you seeing?
Well, I'm seeing The Boy and the Heron.
Oh, good. Oh, you're not seeing the dub? You're going to see the subs?
Theater near me has both, so it'll depend on the time.
I would say not a bad dub.
I like Miyazaki's dub because they always get like people I know, and it can be fun to be like, oh, you're in this? Oh, okay, interesting.
I can't wait for you. If you do see the dub, yeah. I can't wait for you to hear Robert Pattinson.
Yeah, yeah.
No, no, you will be like, oh, okay, interesting choice.
Is he a heron?
He is the titular heron.
Okay. And the monster.
The monster.
I think it's just called Monster. Not with Chinese.
Oh, the Corrieta film?
Yeah.
Yes. That's actually getting released on VOD soon, so that might be my best bet, because it's not playing anywhere. They love to play my indie movies now. Not.
Yeah. Well, point of my story is Japan seems to be having a pretty good month.
Oh, yeah, they're doing great.
Just December belongs to Japan now.
Hell yeah.
So it'll be good to see Godzilla again and get new people to see it. It seems like it's going to come out of this week unscathed, so I think there'll be an extra week of Godzilla. All right. So we're doing a dinosaur movie?
We're doing a dinosaur story.
Okay.
We're back.
I know what you're doing there.
You don't like when I do that stuff.
I'm not encouraging it.
Sorry.
All right, let me take a drink of water.